Warner Schwarzlose 8-shot automatic loading pistol. Accurate and reliable. The faultless automatic or self-loading arm, using the standard 32 caliber automatic cartridges, same as Colt, Browning, Savage, etc. Andreas Schwarzlose was best known for his heavy water-cooled machine gun in use by the Austro-Hungarian army during World War I. However, Mr. Schwarzlose also dabbled in pistol design, patenting and even producing numerous handguns before striking on his most successful design. This is a Schwarzlose blow-forward pistol, sometimes called the 1908 for the bulk of its patent dates and sometimes called the 1909 for the probable first year of full production. The Warner Schwarzlose is not one of the more or less successful limitations of the Browning, but it is an automatic repeating pistol designed from a new point of view, invented by A.W. Schwarzlose, Berlin, inventor of military machine and rapid-fire guns, pistols, etc. The design is an unlocked system, meaning the gun is held closed merely by the pressure of a recoil spring and the mass of the moving parts. Most unlocked guns, like this Colt 1903 pocket hammerless, utilize a blowback system of operation where the recoil energy drives the breech rearwards to cycle the action. Not so with the Schwarzlose. Instead, the blow-forward design features a solid breech from which the barrel moves forward. When fired, the bullet engages the rifling and travels down the barrel, but in so passing, the bullet attempts to drag the barrel forward with it. In most gun designs, this is a negligible effect, as the barrel is secured to the frame or breech in some way, and the rearward recoil energy is a far stronger application of force. But in the Schwarzlose, this is used to pull the barrel forward, eject the spent casing, load a new cartridge, and reset the trigger and hammer. It's all pistol, no superfluous mechanism or weight. Uses standard 32 caliber automatic cartridges. Only these three pieces to take apart for cleaning. No tool required. No small parts to take out and lose or break. Yet, they are so located that you can oil and clean each and every one. Don't this appeal to you? No other pistol like it in the world. Field stripping the Schwarzlose is surprisingly simple. First, remove the magazine and check the gun is empty. Then pull the barrel forward and wedge it open with something such as a spent casing or a penny in this case. Take a small punch and pull the guide rod forward and up, locking it and the recoil spring out of the way. Then the barrel simply slides off the front. Three pieces as advertised, but with slightly more than zero tools required. Some literature asserts that you can simply pull the barrel forward and squeeze the guide rod into the locked position, but I have not found this to be possible on my example. Though not recommended, to further strip the gun, the guide rod and recoil spring can be removed, being careful not to damage the end of the spring that extends into the frame. And the sear bar can be removed from the barrel However, realigning it for reassembly with its tiny attendant springs is not a recommended experience. Reassembly is just the opposite. Replace the spring and guide rod. Which can be a bit of a pain to manage. And lock it back forward, being sure to keep the lug on the top of the guide rod centered within the frame. Slide the barrel back into its rails from the front, and replace the penny or other item in the action. Use the punch to release the guide rod back up into position. Remove the penny, and you are done. The Warner Schwarzlose is guaranteed in every way against faulty material and construction to shoot accurately and give longer range and greater penetration than other automatics using the same cartridge because of its solid breech. With pressure taken off the spring, we can actually observe how the gun operates quite easily. While some of the later Warner pattern guns use a thumb safety, the only safety on the earlier Schwarzlose pattern guns is the grip safety itself. It is rather stiff, but for ease of target shooting, this tab might be pushed up while the grip safety is squeezed and then dropped into place to lock the gun out of its safety mode. In addition to locking the trigger, the grip safety also increases the tension on the main spring that drives the hammer as well as the magazine catch. When neither are engaged, the hammer has fairly little force behind it, but when both are engaged, it gains enough force to reliably detonate primers. While this peculiar feature is far from the most assuring of safety mechanisms, it does have the odd side effect of locking the magazine catch closed while the safety is disengaged. So at least you won't lose your magazine whilst firing. When the trigger is pulled, this wedge-shaped lever moves to the rear. This engages the sear bar here. Wedging it over and disengaging the sear here. This sear is what is holding back the hammer, which then allows it to drop and fire the gun. As the bullet drags the barrel forward, the extractor keeps the empty case pinched to the breech until the force of the hammer nose and the forward-moving sear itself strikes the other side of the case head and ejects it. At the same time, a tab on the back and bottom of the barrel extension pushes a new round up and forward to where it catches in position under the barrel extension feed lever. Once the barrel reaches its full forward extension, the recoil spring drives it back, allowing it to pick up the nose of the new round and chamber it. As it returns, the sear bar flexes upward past the trigger bar. And into this cutout in the frame. This acts as both a trigger disconnector and out of battery safety by keeping the trigger disengaged from the frame until the gun is fully closed up. While still allowing the sear to engage and cock the hammer, thus leaving the gun ready to fire the next round.
All parts are made from the very best material, and all are interchangeable. Duplicate parts may be procured from Kirtland Brothers and Company, who are distributors for the United States. The barrel is made of celebrated Krupp fluid steel, which is itself a guarantee of superior quality, and is rifled after the most approved system by the best precision machines or metal-covered bullets.
As praiseworthy as the advertisements for the gun might have been, production did not last long. Records of labor disputes, bankruptcies, and changes in distributors indicate that the German production of the gun lasted only a little over 1 year, likely ending in 1910 or 1911, with upwards of around 8,000 pistols manufactured. Around 1912, many parts and possibly some production machinery were imported into the U.S. by the Warner Arms Company, and new variants of the gun were marketed as the Warner Schwarzlose pistol, as offered for sale through Kirtland Brothers and Company, from which 1914 catalog we have an advertisement extolling the benefits of this unique pocket pistol.
Advantages of our new Model C. First, a solid breech block, because of which it is safer, shoots harder and farther.
I suppose a solid breech would be more likely to deflect any failure of the gun up and forward, but does the lack of recoil-driven parts really allow more force to be applied to the bullet?
Second, it functions from the shooter, therefore safer again.
Functions from the shooter seems to refer to the barrel moving forward and away from the shooter. Compared to guns like this Colt 1903 pocket hammer, not having a slide that comes off the rear of the gun is a safety improvement, but the idea that a rearward moving slide in any form is more dangerous seems dubious to me at best, especially when cycling the barrel forward leaves one's fingers disturbingly forward of the muzzle.
Third, the Warner Schwarzlose is so constructed that a cartridge cannot be prematurely fired before the cartridge enters the chamber and is closed up tight. A mighty good point.
A mighty good point indeed, which we have already covered. That said, out-of-battery safeties are and were quite common to most pistols, so, yeah, sure, whatever.
Fourth, the Warner Schwarzlose has a 4-inch barrel, while the entire length of the pistol is only 5.5 inches overall. No other automatic pistol can claim this.
This is actually a fair point. The blow-forward design is quite a bit more compact since the chamber closes directly over the magazine instead of in front of it. This Colt 1903 pocket hammerless is over an inch longer, and yet its barrel is over a quarter inch shorter. In fact, this Sauer 1913 is about the same size but limited to a 3-inch barrel, which is over an inch shorter than the Schwarzlose. This means the Schwarzlose should have the combined advantage in both concealability and muzzle velocity over most of its competitors. It also means the chamber is not above the trigger, as in most pistols, but behind it, making the Schwarzlose, by some definitions, actually a bullpup.
Fifth, the outline poise and balance of the Warner Schwarzlose is such that even the novice shooter will shoot straight with it, like pointing the finger, with either left hand or right. It don't fly up at the muzzle, same as common pistols and revolvers do.
Okay, so they claim it is a good point shooter. We can test that. They also claim it has minimal muzzle flip. This too we can test.
Sixth, safety device is such that pistol cannot be fired when the safe is on. It blocks the trigger and blocks the hammer at the half cock. Throw it around as much as you like, even though the sear would jar out of the hammer notch, the hammer cannot fall. When desired, a slight pressure of the thumb throws off the safety for 8 quick, effective shots. One good safety is better than two.
Well, this one mostly refers to the later Warner patterns that had a thumb safety instead of a grip safety. But the point is taken that safety is indeed the safest thing.
The satisfaction and confidence inspired by having a Warner Schwarzlose automatic pistol in your home or on your person is immense. Its accurate, hard-shooting qualities give the possessor of it a feeling of safety, surety, and self-reliance.
The ad heralds the Schwarzlose as being quite accurate, and it would seem to be at least as accurate as I am at self-defense distances. However, the problem isn't so much with the accuracy of the barrel as it is with the accuracy of the sights. As you can see here, the front sight is far taller than the rear notch, making finding and repeating the correct sight picture noticeably difficult. The ad also asserts that a solid breech directs more force downrange, and boasts a 4-inch barrel doing the same. A quick comparison of chronograph results against a Colt should clear this up.
862. 887. 897. 877. 884. 871. 947. 943. 922. 871.
As it turns out, the Colt averaged 881 feet per second with Winchester white box ammunition, but the Schwarzlose outperformed it by 30 feet per second with an average of 911 feet per second. How much more of that is from the solid breech versus the longer barrel? That I can't say. The ad makes the claim that the forward-traveling barrel also reduces muzzle flip. Again, we can compare the Schwarzlose with the Colt by tracking their front sights in slow motion. 32 ACP is not by any means an unmanageable round, and both guns ultimately showed very similar amounts of muzzle flip. Does the Schwarzlose shoot fairly flat? Yes. Does it shoot flatter than its competitors? Probably not. Of course, the ad goes on to claim the pistol to be a natural point shooter. I can't claim that I am, but let's try some close-range, 1900-style, one-handed, quick double-tap drills with both guns and see what we can get. With the Colt, I got all 6 rounds on paper with a maximum dispersion of about 8.5 inches. With the Schwarzlose, the dispersion would have been a half inch better if I hadn't fully missed the paper altogether with the first 2 shots. While it's not terrible at close-up snap shooting, the gun still does not sit as naturally in the hand as do many others. Finally, the ad claims that the gun is a pleasure and a delight to shoot. The super slow motion video not only reveals the captivating operation of the gun, but also the astonishing amount of recoil being dumped into the hand and wrist from a mere 32 ACP. One would assume that this comes primarily from the lack of rearward moving parts absorbing part of the recoil energy, but even high-powered revolvers are generally more pleasant to shoot, and they don't have any energy-absorbing parts. The barrel slamming back home certainly adds more prolonged force to the recoil impulse, but just cycling the gun by hand, it doesn't seem sufficient to make up the difference of what is felt. I think the biggest culprit is the narrow 5/8 inch metal backstrap of the grip that hits all the worst parts of the palm. This, combined with these other factors and the relative snappiness of most pistol cartridges, and you get a felt recoil that is sharper and more painful than probably just about any other handgun I have ever fired.
The pleasure derived from a Warner Schwarzlose at target shooting is supreme. Probably with no other pistol on the market can you derive such satisfaction. Its long range, straight shooting, and hard-hitting qualities are a source of extreme delight to every lover of outdoor sports and especially appeal to men who are advocates of the rod and gun.
Well, so, satisfaction and pleasure are terms that I would use for the Schwarzlose as a collector's piece, but I would not apply them to the shooting experience. The gun is fantastically cool, mechanically speaking. The bullpup design of the action does allow for a very compact pistol with a longer than average barrel and greater velocity and penetration potential from the 32 ACP cartridge. Beyond this, the gun did not fare any better in practical shooting than did the earlier Colt 1903 pocket hammerless, but it did have worse ergonomics and poorly designed sights. The blow-forward action requires care to operate so your fingers don't end up downrange of a freshly loaded barrel, and if fired in direct contact with an assailant, the gun would undoubtedly fail the cycle. So, my review of the Schwarzlose 1908 or 1909 is that I hate it so much that I love it. It is absolutely hateful to actually use, rather ugly in appearance, but mechanically fascinating and fairly elegant. The amount of work that had to go into milling the barrel and extension alone is mind-boggling. So, who is this gun for? Well, masochists or collectors, I suppose. Or folks with a time machine and $12 to spare. Anyway, thanks to the folks over at CN Arsenal for providing the scan of the Kirtland Brothers catalog, and thank you for having spent part of your finite existence watching this video.
It autos as it ought to, from the shootout.